Good evening, everybody. My name is Jacinta Thompson, and I'm the Executive Director of the Hawke Centre at UniSA. Very big welcome to you all. I would like to actually welcome you all here on behalf of the Hawke Centre and the University of South Australia to Wars, Laws and Humanity, 100 years of Australian Red Cross action, with the CEO of Australian Red Cross, Mr. Robert Tickner. Before we start, I would like to pay our respects to the Kaurna people on whose land we meet, in the place of the Red Kangaroo Dreaming. We thank the elders and recognise the ongoing connection to country for Kaurna people. The Hawke Centre offers a year-long program of events and exhibitions which encourage attendees to think, connect and act in spheres where social responsibility is needed. We work with government, NGOs, charitable groups and community organisations to achieve this, and tonight is no exception. We are very, very pleased to be co-presenting this event with Australian Red Cross tonight. You will have seen in the foyer an information table about the work of the Australian Red Cross. Please take time after the lecture to chat with the volunteers and find out more about this amazing organisation. The session tonight is being recorded and a podcast of the event will be available on the Hawke Centre website later this week. The video will also be available on the Hawke Centre's YouTube channel, as well as APAC, Australian Public Affairs channel, very shortly. Details are all available on our website. We encourage you to bring this to the attention of your friends and colleagues who could not make this lecture tonight, so please guide them to the website so they can listen to this lecture tonight. And a reminder, please switch phones to silent to avoid interruptions. However, feel free to join the Twitter conversation at the Hawke Centre or Red Cross AU or using hashtag RedCross100. Robert will also be taking questions after his presentation, but please keep this short so that we can have a lot of questions before we have to vacate the room. We've had a fantastic response to tonight's event, and thank you to everyone for coming along. There are audience members from the legal and health professions. A number of students are here tonight studying international humanitarian law. And we have many representatives from the Australian Red Cross and other NGOs, as well as government departments and, of course, interested individuals. I would, however, like to acknowledge one of the Hawke Centre's patrons, Professor Luigi O'Donoghue. It is really lovely to see you tonight, so thank you for coming along and supporting the Hawke Centre. So I would now like to ask Sue Varden, who is the State Chair of the Australian Red Cross, to come and introduce our wonderful speaker for tonight.
Thank you, Jacinta. Thank you, and good evening, everybody. It gives me a great deal of pleasure to introduce Robert Tickner, a man who has my deep admiration. I thought that first I'd like to say some thank yous and to acknowledge that we are on the land of the Kaurna people, and I pay my respects to the elders past and present. It's wonderful to see Loetje O'Donoghue, who has had a long association with Robert, but particularly she was on the Red Cross board for a while, so it's a special connection to us. Also present in the audience, we have Penny Stratman, who is the South Australian chair of our centenary. We have Professor Melanie Oppenheimer, who has written the 100-year history of Red Cross, which will be launched in South Australia on the 14th of August. Helen Connolly is here, who is the Executive Director of Red Cross, and our patron, Val Broadbent, is sitting in the front. So it's lovely that the Red Cross family is here to support this important event. When we started thinking about the centenary of South Australia, we thought, let's have lots of celebration. There have been people here who have worked continuously through branches who have been here for 100 years. people haven't been here 100 years. I always get that wrong. The branches have been here for 100 years. All throughout South Australia, there's been a wonderful humanitarian movement to make things better in this place. But we wanted the celebration, but we also wanted, so acknowledging the past, we wanted people to know that we were more than just blood and disasters, that there is a very large expanse of everyday humanitarian work. And we also wanted to position ourselves for the future. We were looking for a serious statement from this state about war laws and the humanitarian response that Red Cross represented. And we could think of no better speaker than Robert to come and represent us. I'd like to thank Jacinta Thompson and Louise Cunnell for the incredible amount of support that they've done to help us get this off today. Robert's been our Secretary General since February 2005. In Australia, we're a bit more humble, we only call him a Chief Executive. But throughout the world, the people who head up Red Crosses are called Secretary Generals. Prior to his appointment, of course, he was known as the CEO of Job Futures, which was a very large network of community-based employment providers. Mostly, of course, he's best known as the former Federal Minister for Aboriginal and Torres Strait Island Affairs. And he still holds the honour of being the longest serving minister in that area in Australia's history. And he was there from 90 to 96. And with his skills that he learned as a minister and also as a councillor on the City of Sydney, it's a good place to learn your skills, he was able to bring not only the incredible knowledge about Aboriginal affairs and the way government works, but he brought very strong small p political skills, which culminated, or I suppose, which for me was highlighted by his single-handed passion, and he certainly got a lot of other people, but it was his commitment to get the whole of the Red Cross movement to take a stand against nuclear weapons, which they did in 2011 in Geneva, and I was there, most emotional day of my life. And I have to say, if it hadn't been for Robert and his political skills, it wouldn't have happened. He made incredible speeches against this. But he also managed to get every country but one, and that one only abstained for funny, peculiar reasons. I can't understand why, even to this day. But the whole of the Red Cross movement supported it. That doesn't happen very often. And since then, he's driven, with other countries, he'll talk about that tonight, with other countries, the continuation of this resistance. And he's been able to persuade lots of people that there can be no humanitarian response if there is nuclear war. I just wanted to quickly mention that Robert has led Red Cross through some very difficult times. The first one was that when he started with Red Cross, it was seven different fiefdoms, and he has drawn us together as a national body. He has harmonised the way we do business. He has focused on specific areas of business, and he has changed the model to empowerment rather than to helping people in a paternalistic kind of a way. He has changed the community engagement, the concept of collaboration inside, and that's been very important. Having succeeded in that, he now has to take us through very difficult times, which is about changes in government policy, restriction in funding, real challenges to collaboration in the not-for-profit sector, which we're very strong about, and things like the introduction of the private sector into the business, which has been traditionally into the not-for-profit sector. So he is a great leader. He will take us through. He has given us a vision for the future, and it's my great pleasure to introduce him tonight.
Well, thank you very much, Sue. You're much, much too kind in your introduction, because everything we do in Red Cross is a team effort, as you'll hear tonight. But can I also say how delightful it is to see Lowitja here. We've got some shared battle scars, I think, and a very strong friendship that goes back some time, and it's absolutely wonderful to see her here. It's with great honour and privilege that I've been asked to deliver this lecture for the Hawke Centre, which of course is named as a centre in honour of the Prime Minister in whose government I served as a former Minister for Aboriginal and Torres Strait Islander Affairs from April 1990 until Bob Hawke left office at the end of 1991. I rarely, if ever, mention my former life when I'm talking about things for Red Cross, as these days I'm very far removed from the combative and political war zone of the National Parliament. However, I share with Jim Carlton, one of my predecessors in this role as the CEO of Red Cross, the experience of holding ministerial office in the Government of Australia, as he did as Minister for Health in the Fraser Government. And like him, I'm extraordinarily grateful for the privilege I was given to serve in that role. I was deeply aware of the enormity of the challenge, but also the sense of obligation and responsibility I had when I took that role. History records that it was a time of significant cross-party progress in Aboriginal and Torres Strait Islander affairs in the time that I've reflected on. And we were able to get legislation unanimously passed through the Australian Parliament to establish a decade-long process of reconciliation between the First Peoples of the land, the Aboriginal and Torres Strait Islander peoples, and the wider Australian community. I'd like to pay tribute to the Shadow Minister for Aboriginal and Torres Strait Islander Affairs, Michael Woolridge, for his work in bringing the coalition on side. That process of reconciliation has, of course, not finished, and indeed we have significant work to do. Red Cross is proud to be part of the huge cross-section of the Australian people who are supporting both constitutional recognition for the First Australians and also the continuing work to address disadvantage and injustice so necessary to have a true and lasting reconciliation in this country. I've reminded you a little bit of this history of the fight for Indigenous rights because it shows something powerful and relevant to the issues associated with international humanitarian law evolution, which I want to highlight in this lecture. The lesson is that history shows that great gains in social progress can be made when people of goodwill take a stand and sometimes put aside party political differences to work for the common good and a better world. Sadly, we see all too little of this in our body politic in the current times. But I'm forever an optimist and believe that the campaign to render the use of nuclear weapons contrary to international law is just such a campaign to bring people together. First, let me set the context, if I can, for the work of Red Cross on this global critical issue of international humanitarian law. Australian Red Cross was formed in August of 1914, just 9 days after the outbreak of World War I, and has been part of the fabric of the Australian community for 100 years. And later this year, as Sue Varden said, we'll be launching the centenary history of our Red Cross, and it's great that Melanie Oppenheimer, our author, is with us tonight. During the course of this year, there'll be great celebrations as we applaud the wonderful work of our members and volunteers in war and in peace over the past 100 years. We're using this centenary year to drive innovation and renewal across the organisation, because to do otherwise would be a betrayal of our founders, and we need a new generation of humanitarians to carry on the work. After 95 years as operating as a relatively siloed state and territory Red Cross organisations with separate state boards and CEOs, we now have a cohesive national framework with only one national board with governance authority and with a CEO responsible to the national board. I think it's so powerfully significant that these changes were unanimously approved back in 2009, when people gave up state-based authority for the common good of the organisation. We then conducted a comprehensive review of all our services and resolved to focus our work in 7 priority areas in addition to the Australian Red Cross Blood Service. Red Cross also focused on how we work, and that is why we've adopted our ways of working document, which sets out the ethical framework for the delivery of our services and our commitment to such things as empowerment, community development, respecting issues of gender and diversity, meeting the challenges of climate change, focusing on monitoring and evaluation of our work, and always the ongoing commitment to impartiality and neutrality. These and other key principles shape the way we work. The 7 priority areas of our programs, in addition to the blood service, that are underpinned by these ways of working are international work with a priority but not exclusive focus in the Asia Pacific area, international and domestic disasters and emergencies, work with asylum seekers and refugees, and we've currently have some 12,000 clients. We work in programs in partnership with Aboriginal and Torres Strait Islander people, tackling social exclusion by so many marginalised groups, reaching out to vulnerable people in the community, whether it's young offenders, former offenders and their families, as I've said, older people living in the community. Increasingly, we've got a place-based focus for our work, where social problems have proven so intractable over time. And here we need to maximise our collective impact on these issues with others in the sector, with government, and with those who are prepared to fund our work. And finally, there is our work in international humanitarian law, where Australian Red Cross has become one of the global leaders among the Red Cross and Red Crescent societies of the world. And I now want to focus my remainder of my lecture on this important area of our work. Globally, we are part of a federation which stands for a peaceful world and promotes non-violence in our communities. Our work in IHL, International Humanitarian Law, can be traced back to the movement's creation 150 years ago, and our global mandate to alleviate suffering during times of conflict. Many members of the public in Australia are surprised when they learn that our mandate in international humanitarian law, which is found in the Geneva Conventions and the additional protocols, aims to reduce suffering during times of armed conflict. They are lucky individuals. They've never had to receive a Red Cross relief parcel or have found desperately sought after news about their loved ones from a Red Cross tracing service. Yet our work in raising awareness that even wars have laws is one of our very long-standing areas of work in Australia, and we champion the ideas that civilians should be spared during conflict, that the Red Cross and Red Crescent emblems should be protected, and that medical and humanitarian aid should be provided safe access during conflict, that war criminals should be prosecuted, and that there are method and means of warfare, including specific weapons, that are illegal or should be illegal under international law. We leverage our unique auxiliary status with public authorities in the humanitarian field to provide technical advice on how to reduce suffering during times of armed conflict. We train key groups in this regard across Australia, including, of course, in the armed forces. Our work in IHL is an area we are proudly promoting during our centenary year, celebrating our past successes and looking to our hopes in this area. One of our deepest and significant hope for the future centres around the most critical humanitarian issue confronting the world today, the need to rid the world of nuclear weapons. It's important at the start to place on record our specific way of raising issues of humanitarian diplomacy. Red Cross is different in this regard. We use our fundamental principles, our principle of humanity, as the basis for pressing the need to speak out and urge action. Our principle of impartiality, to cut through the idea that nuclear weapons fail to distinguish between race, nationality, class, and religious belief in the utter devastation they deliver. Our principle of neutrality demonstrates that our concerns do not lie in controversies of a political or ideological nature, but rather rest with the survival of the human race itself. Our principle of independence, which urges us to continue to engage with government and authorities, even if they don't agree with us, in a respectful but consistent manner, with the aim of achieving policies and decisions that are humane. Our principle of voluntary service, to harness the goodwill and commitment and desire of millions of people who are sick of living in a world that is threatened by nuclear weapons. And our principles of unity and universality, which now sees this global movement found in almost every country on Earth with a strong and unanimous policy to end the era of nuclear weapons. But as a movement, we do not exclusively locate our work to rid the world of nuclear weapons within our IHL mandate and the fundamental principles that states have granted us. Our commitment to this topic is also found in our experience, including in particular that of our colleagues in the International Committee of the Red Cross, the ICRC, and the Japanese Red Cross. As you know, on the 6th of August 1945, a white flash appeared over Hiroshima. Seconds later, the city was flattened. Tens of thousands of people were immediately dead, and hundreds of thousands, of course, eventually died. In the midst of this appalling devastation, one hospital could be seen, the Hiroshima Red Cross Hospital. Over the next few days, it struggled to treat the many thousands who sought assistance. On top of this, the very first non-military doctor to assist was Dr. Marcel Junot, a health delegate with the ICRC. And if you visit Hiroshima today, you'll see a very moving tribute to Dr. Junot and the International Committee of the Red Cross in the Peace Park in Hiroshima. Today, the Japanese Red Cross still runs the hospitals dealing with the horrors of the use of nuclear weapons in both Hiroshima and in Nagasaki. Thus, since this very first use of nuclear weapons, Red Cross has been raising its voice against these weapons, weapons that should be unambiguously and conclusively recognised as violating the principles of IHL and that of humanity. In more recent times, our work on this issue has intensified, and I believe we're now at a crossroads, a decision point, if you like, on whether we push forward to create a legally binding instrument to deal with clarity and precision on these issues of nuclear weapons, or whether we pass them on as some kind of inheritance of horror to future generations. I'll emphasise again later that the central tenet of my plea tonight is namely this, that the time has come for the nations of the world to unite to declare the use of nuclear weapons in any circumstances as contrary to international humanitarian law. As a global community, we've acted against chemical and biological weapons, anti-personnel landmines, cluster munitions, but the most barbaric weapon of all, nuclear weapons, is not outlawed by a specific international convention. I'll spend some time explaining the current status of the work we're doing, but first I wanted to flag some of the great examples of how Australia has influenced these and wider international debates in the past. Australia's got a long history of making a significant contribution to modern international humanitarian law. Australian High Court judge and former Foreign Minister Dr. Evatt, appointed in 1948 as President of the General Assembly, and of course the only Australian to hold this post, is in many ways the founding parent of this contribution, which began with the United Nations Charter. I'm pleased to say that future Australian governments from all political parties have, to a greater or lesser extent, built on this contribution. And while I don't have time to refer to them all today, it's indisputable that all sides of politics over time have provided important contributions. For example, the Hawke government created the or helped support the creation of the South Pacific Nuclear Free Zone Treaty. In 1986, it also enacted implementing legislation, effectively ruling out the nuclear weapons option for Australia. And I'm pleased to say it's one of my modest life achievements to have taken up this debate within the government at the time for the argument and the arguments for passing this legislation. And it was, of course, an act of the Australian Parliament that may well not have been embraced by all the nuclear weapons powers at that time, some of whom were our closest and respected allies. In the late 1990s, Australia chaired the like-minded group of states who were pushing for a strong and fair international criminal court. And under the Howard government, we were amongst the first nations to sign and ratify this significant treaty and to incorporate the changes required into our domestic law. At other times, Australia has shown a willingness to take the tough stand on nuclear issues, and indeed Gareth Evans did this when giving Australia's submission to the International Court of Justice in their advisory opinion on the legality of the threat of the use of nuclear weapons. His statement argued the case, and I quote, that nuclear weapons are by their nature illegal under customary international law, by virtue of fundamental general principles of humanity. It is illegal not only to use or threaten to use nuclear weapons, but to acquire, develop, test, or possess them. The right of states to self-defence cannot be invoked to justify such actions. End quote. The then Minister Evans also noted, and I quote again, that the use by a state of a nuclear weapon against a particular group may constitute the crime of genocide, end quote. Other Australian leaders who've taken steps towards action on this issue are numerous. One of the reasons for the establishment of the Canberra Commission on the Elimination of Nuclear Weapons in 1995 was set out by then Prime Minister Paul Keating, who said, "The issue of nuclear weapons worries me more than any other when I think about the sort of world young Australians will inherit." Kevin Rudd, having been moved by his own visit to Hiroshima, also established a commission headed by Gareth Evans to boost nuclear disarmament efforts. But it's important to remember that no political party has a monopoly of leadership on international humanitarian law issues. And over the years, as I've said, all sides of politics have demonstrated at times great courage and done the right thing in relation to international humanitarian law issues. For example, in 1996, I remember that year well, following a change of government, the new Foreign Minister Downer and Defence Minister McLaughlin announced that Australia would be changing its policy and supporting a global ban on the use, transfer, production and stockpile of anti-personnel mines. I know those names well. This was a magnificent example, let me say on the record, a magnificent example of foreign policy that took humanitarian issues into account. I've spoken about the early work of the Red Cross movement and that of the Australian government on this issue, but of course it's not just government and parliamentarians who are often taking a stand. And the Australian people have shown a strong collective voice on this issue, including against French nuclear testing in the Pacific. And long before I joined Red Cross, I remember carrying my two-year-old son Jack on my shoulders through the streets of Sydney in a march opposing French testing. Above and beyond our IHL mandate, however, Red Cross also sees the need to raise the unacceptable humanitarian consequences within the context of our inability to adequately respond to these weapons should they be used. as part of a movement which is globally recognised for its role and capacity to respond to natural disasters, we've got an obligation, I think, to speak up on these issues. We're part of the world's largest and oldest humanitarian movement, and a movement which has a permanent presence, as I've said, in almost every country in the world, and the capacity to mount a global response to address disasters, such as we've seen in the earthquake in Haiti, floods and earthquakes in Pakistan, and so many other areas around the world. But even large expert organisations like the International Red Cross and Red Crescent Movement and other actors such as the United Nations, for all their vast resources and expertise, have seen that humanitarian responders can be overwhelmed even in the face of natural disasters. The 2004 tsunami, which as we know tragically killed over 230,000 people, push the world's humanitarian responders to their coping capacity. The humanitarian consequences of the blast, the heat, the electromagnetic pulse and radiation associated with nuclear explosions are insurmountable for medical and humanitarian responders and are not even reasonably comparable to the experiences with natural disasters of the past. The total destruction, not just of the impact site, but extensive areas surrounding the impact of foregone conclusions, making the inability of those left to respond almost non-existent. The loss of life, the incapacity of trained medical personnel and humanitarian response personnel, and damage to property and stocks of resources used for emergency response would significantly impact on any potential response by humanitarians. Inability to safely access the affected area would also hamper the response. Caring for survivors of a natural disaster is always very difficult, but in the case of a nuclear war, not even being able to access those affected, it would simply be impossible. Furthermore, the long-term response would clearly be beyond any organisation's capacity to respond. The effects of flooding, fires, cyclones and earthquakes provide enough challenges with respect to the restoration of livelihoods. But nuclear fallout from a nuclear war and its long-term destructive nature would have catastrophic environmental consequences. It would mean that vast tracts of land could not be used by humans for an indefinite period of time. The spread of radiation would not just affect the current generation, but generations to come. The displacement of people would be an insurmountable global issue, and so much research has predicted that mass starvation would be a very real possibility on a global level. The global community has been told by many sources, including British and American medical associations and the World Health Organization, that there's no possibility of an adequate medical response to the use of nuclear weapons. Today, however, we're not talking about the possibility of another Hiroshima or Nagasaki, horrendous as they were. We're facing the prospect of something much, much worse. Today, the destructive force of the world's nuclear arsenal is equivalent to approximately 150,000 Hiroshima bombs. A small nuclear warhead, by today's standards, has an explosive yield of about 20 times that of the Hiroshima bomb. Humanity has no response to such brutality. The destruction caused by nuclear weapons is simply beyond humanitarian response, and the Global Red Cross and Red Crescent movement is unambiguous in saying that. What is extremely disturbing, however, to go beyond that, and not highlighted enough, is the high chance of an accidental use of nuclear weapons. The respected author Eric Schlosser, in his book Command and Control, raises this point with chilling clarity, giving example after example of near misses which have occurred with potential devastating consequences. As Schlosser concludes, and I quote, Right now, thousands of missiles are hidden away, literally out of sight, topped with warheads and ready to go. They are a collective death wish, barely suppressed. They're out there, waiting, soulless and mechanical, and sustained by our denial. And they work. End quote. Despite the absence of a specific convention, our position is clear that we as a movement find it difficult to envisage how the use of any nuclear weapons could be compatible with the rules of IHL. As I've explained, IHL is known as the Laws of War. However, neither the Geneva Conventions nor the 1977 additional protocols, the cornerstones of IHL, specifically mention weapons of any kind. Rather, they provide principles to guide these debates. These general and fundamental principles of IHL govern the use of all weapons and not just nuclear weapons in times of conflict. The rules include the following: a prohibition on attacks directed at civilians or civilian objects, a prohibition on attacks that cannot distinguish between civilian and military people or objects, a rule that any damage caused must be proportionate to the military objective, a rule that weapons cannot be used if they cause unnecessary or superfluous injury, and a rule related to the protection of the natural environment. I would contend, after hearing about the absolute devastation that these weapons can cause, that it would be difficult for anyone to argue that those effects are compatible with the rules I've just explained. However, despite all this, in 1996, the International Court of Justice, in an advisory opinion, failed, by a slim majority, but failed, to unambiguously conclude that nuclear weapons were at all times and circumstances contrary to international law. With all the issues I've raised to date in mind, there was an historic turning point where the movement raised its voice with strong certainty and in a defining moment in 2011, adopting a resolution at the Council of Delegates, the highest decision-making body of the International Red Cross and Red Crescent movement, made up of almost 190 Red Cross and Red Crescent societies, the International Committee of the Red Cross, the custodian of the Geneva Convention, and the International Federation. This Council of Delegates resolution is carefully crafted. It builds on many of the promising legal and political developments that have occurred in recent years in a variety of fora, including the NPT, the Non-Proliferation Treaty processes, the 1996 International Court of Justice advisory opinion that I've referred to on the threat of nuclear weapons, and from resolutions from international conferences of the Red Cross and Red Crescent movement, which are adopted by the movement and all the signatories to the Geneva Convention. So to explain, that international conference includes, under the statutes of the movement, not only all the Red Cross and Red Crescent societies, but the governments of the world actually come to those meetings if they're signatories to the Geneva Convention. This resolution from 2011 sets out our clear aims in this area, which are simple. One, that the weapons are never used again, and two, that states create a legally binding international agreement using existing international legal obligations to ban the use and to eliminate their existence. This resolution was built upon last year when the movement gathered in Sydney and adopted a follow-up resolution setting out in more detail the sorts of activities to be implemented by Red Cross and Red Crescent societies in order to influence their governments and public opinion globally. First and foremost, these documents guide our work, which ensures that we approach the critical issue of nuclear weapons in a consistent and credible way. That's no mean feat when you're dealing with now 189 national societies, the Federation, and the International Committee of Red Cross. But we stand as one on this issue. The value of these resolutions is clear. With their consistent messaging and legal analysis, The resolutions provide National Red Cross and Red Crescent societies the tools and give them the role of engaging with their authorities, including their governments, with other decision makers and key groups in their societies, and gives them confidence. The resolution also clearly envisages communication by national societies with the people of their country through a wide-ranging means, including the use of social media. Many and diverse governments, including the government of New Zealand, as well as civil society actors, have embraced this resolution. The resolution has been recognised and read out in parliaments around the world. The resolution was also noted in significant statements of many governments in wider settings, such as the First Committee of the United Nations General Assembly, the Non-Proliferation Treaty meetings as well. Signatories to these joint statements have grown from 16 states in May 2012 to 125 by October 2013. This is tremendously uplifting developments, as I'm sure you will agree. Our work on this issue has been critical in shifting the debate from military doctrine and strategy concerns to one of the humanitarian imperatives. In March 2013, the Norwegian government hosted the first ever conference dedicated solely to the humanitarian impacts of nuclear weapons. The first ever conference as recently as 2013 with that focus. Over 120 nations or states attended, and the ICRC was accorded a respected status as one of the leading keynote speakers at the conference, and the importance of the movement resolution from 2011 was unambiguously recognised. A follow-up conference in February 2014, earlier this year in Mexico, saw 146 states attend, and on this occasion, the ICRC, together with the International Federation of Red Cross and Red Crescent, delivered a landmark joint statement which recognised the need for the movement to continue to speak with one voice on this critical humanitarian issue. At the conclusion of this conference, the chair of the conference announced that he believed that the time had come for a diplomatic process to eliminate these weapons, calling the Mexico conference the point of no return. However, our work in Australian Red Cross is not solely limited to engaging with decision makers, and perhaps this is where we've continued to evolve very dramatically, both with and will go beyond our first 100 years. The ability to engage with all Australians while maintaining our absolute neutrality is critical. I believe our work on this is really leading the way, and I pay tribute to the initiative demonstrated by our young humanitarians on this issue, and some of them are in this forum tonight. Using social media, regular media, holding seminars, events, and a range of creative activities like flash mobs, our young humanitarians have been a very significant part of our work in this area. However, as well as strong support from all age groups who care about our future, we need our politicians to listen and to respond to these deep humanitarian concerns, and to see Australia work closely with like-minded states such as New Zealand on this issue. Red Cross has a long and proud history of working closely and independently with successive governments in Australia on a range of critical IHL issues. We work in a cross-party way. We're proud of the fact that we've got an Australian Parliamentary Friends of Red Cross made up of the Coalition, the Labor Party, the Greens and Independents and others in the Parliament. You know, we work in a way that is always neutral and impartial. We're transparent with authorities here in Australia, and provided all sides of politics with our resolutions and plans for activities. It's a matter of public record that until earlier this year, we'd received very positive responses from the major political parties, which we believed supported the efforts of the International Committee of the Red Cross and the movement on the issue of nuclear weapons. Our first engagement with government on this issue was in late 2010, where we spelt out the work of Australian Red Cross and the ICRC and what was being done to raise the issue of the humanitarian consequence of nuclear weapons with a strong voice. This was followed by further letters after the adoption of the 2011 and 2013 resolutions, as well as regular updates of the work of the movement during this period. The former Labor government initially sent letters of support and encouragement for our activities. However, we were rather concerned when we learnt via a Freedom of Information request by another organisation that political factors got in the way of the humanitarian debate. Similarly, when the current government was in opposition, we received a strongly worded letter of support from the then Shadow Minister for Foreign Affairs. More recently, we are aware that the sentiment in these letters is not reflective of either the government's nor the opposition's current foreign policies, neither of which yet appear to support the goal of a legally binding international agreement prohibiting the use of and complete elimination of nuclear weapons as adopted by the International Red Cross and Red Crescent movement. The support for this sort of policy is hardly a radical proposition, as the Prime Minister of the Conservative Government of New Zealand has demonstrated. We continue to maintain good relations with all political parties in Australia, and as our principles of humanity and independence require, we'll continue to raise these issues in an open, frank and respectful manner on all occasions. Tonight, I reaffirm the intention of Red Cross to champion this issue in the Australian community in line with our movement's principles. On a personal level, I'm lucky to have left public life with an absence of bitterness in my heart, and with my belief in the capacity of people of goodwill to take a stand on issues which will help a built better world, as I've foreshadowed at the beginning of this lecture, I believe that great things are possible. My dear friend Tom Jurens always told me, and I believe this, that there's no progress in hate. And we've seen those principles lived out as we find common ground with the Japanese Red Cross on the global campaign to eliminate nuclear weapons. We need our political leaders in this country to come together on the nuclear weapons issue and to take a principled stand, even if that's contrary to the wishes of the current nuclear weapons states, whoever they might be. With a lack of any available humanitarian response, we deeply believe that the people of the world are strongly united behind the need for further regulation, such as a convention, and we're committed to mobilising the power of humanity to achieve this outcome, which we believe may well change the course of human history. And in that grand sweep of history, there are often great landmarks of social progress which have taken us to a better place, and I've mentioned some of those tonight, and the work of people from different parts of the political spectrum. It also occurred with the founding of the Red Cross movement by Henri Dunant, and soon afterwards with the first Geneva Convention. More recently, as I've said, we've seen the achievement of conventions on biological and chemical weapons, successful efforts to ban the use of anti-personnel landmines and cluster munitions, as well as the regulation of the transfer of small arms. For the last 100 years, Australian Red Cross has been a strong part of this humanitarian journey to build a more compassionate, safer and peaceful world. It is now time that we as a global community deal decisively with nuclear weapons, and we call for leadership from all our parliamentarians on this issue. This, I believe, is an issue whose time has come, and we call on people of goodwill who share our humanitarian values to get behind and join us and join our movement in efforts to rid the world of nuclear weapons. Thank you so very much for the privilege of talking to you tonight.
Look, thanks very much for your speech, and it's nice to be in your presence of yourself. One thing that was ticking through my mind when I was listening to you was, in an attempt to rid the world of nuclear weapons, in a strange way we create an opportunity to further endanger it. And what's springing to my mind is, with the fall of Russia, there was the sale of, or the reported sale of nuclear devices and the discussions about dirty bombs and how terrorists could come into a city and potentially detonate a device discreetly. So what is the Red Cross's attitude to that? And what's happening? I'm sorry, I'm just...
Okay. Well, first of all, thank you for the first question. And I think if I can just establish a really important threshold principle, and I do it very unapologetically and up front, that Red Cross's mandate is a very clear, precise aspect of all its work. And one thing that Red Cross doesn't do anywhere is essentially get into the political debate or the policy debate that is ultimately going to be played out by governments, by nation states, and by civil society. What we do is focus very much on our mandate and the humanitarian principles that I've outlined to you today. But the point you raise should also be responded to by stressing that the laws of war, the humanitarian principles that I've been talking about today, are intended to be of universal application. And I should add that, you know, a convention which essentially makes the use of nuclear weapons illegal will not of itself immediately overnight remove every nuclear weapon from the global landscape. But what has been seen from the similar processes around conventions in other areas is that a prohibition on the use of a weapon starts to change the whole culture of the global community around an issue. So my answer to you is the principle's universal. They would apply or do apply to everyone, but the kind of policy debate, if you like, that's played out in the wider debate around disarmament is not a space that Red Cross gets into. And that is not a cop-out, I need to say that, it's because it's a great strength of Red Cross that it gives us a voice that is heard and respected. Red Cross is impartial, it's neutral, and it gets to do things that other actors can't do. And I'm always reminded, you know, in a different context, but it's a similar kind of principle. You know, when you hear Nelson Mandela write of him, you've heard him speak and read what he wrote about his time in Robben Island and the way he respected the International Committee of the Red Cross because it could gain access to him, but did so because it was impartial and neutral and could get out in there. So that's my answer to your question. Thank you.
Australian Red Cross with United States Red Cross.
Well, the International Red Cross and Red Crescent movement is quite simple to understand, but it's important to perhaps just stress these elements. Firstly, there is the International Committee of the Red Cross, which has been around for 150 years. It's a Swiss organisation, and it has the crucial role of being broadly described as the custodian of the Geneva Conventions. And then the movement is also made up of 189 Red Cross or Red Crescent societies in not all but almost every country on earth, and they in turn form themselves into a global federation, of which American Red Cross not only is a part, it was one of the founders, and Australian Red Cross is part of that foundation. What I can say to you is that every single Red Cross and Red Crescent society in the world voted in support of the resolutions that I've been talking about. So I don't pretend that there isn't a great diversity in Red Cross and Red Crescent societies as there is among the people of the world, you know.
Including the United States?
Yeah, yeah. The United States, the American Red Cross supported the resolution, yes.
Thank you for your talk. I'm glad to hear the Red Cross is taking this stand. But back in the 60s and 70s, I was actually scared of the bomb, and there was a lot of action against it. Now it seems to have receded as an issue, perhaps because there's been no case of actually using this weapon since Hiroshima and Nagasaki. Does that make your job easier or harder?
Well, you know, no one would wish any more near accidents, of which there have been, you know, dozens and dozens over time. No one would wish, you know, for the threat of the use of a weapon to materialise. I mean, it's just too horrible to contemplate, and none of us could ever predict what would happen as a consequence. This book by this fellow Eric Schlosser is not a fringe contribution to the debate. This guy is a mainstream, serious thinker and writer, and he's got the most detailed recording and annotated history of these near misses. It's enough to seriously scare anyone. So I think there's enough evidence out there, noting the fact that while there has been progress made in some aspects of nuclear disarmament, the sideways spread, horizontal spread of nuclear weapons is a known fact. It's increased. So I think the threat is every bit as real. So you are right that, you know, the global movement is not the same as it was in the 60s, but I think the threat is greater. I honestly do. And I think that one of the things that we're seeing is this amazing movement by these countries all around the world who literally are now focusing on the humanitarian consequences. They're doing something that never happened before. You know, imagine waiting until, you know, 2012 for a, or 2013, I should say, before we had the first ever conference of governments focusing on the humanitarian consequences. It's an absolute turning point. So you're getting all these countries who are really starting now to come together and focus on this issue. And we don't know, it's not the job of Red Cross to chart a course for what those nations do. But what we say is that there does need to be some kind of process that will take the global community forward. And it's up to the nations of the world to choose that path of how we get there.
In the early 1970s, I was privileged to attend, as part of an Australian delegation, conferences called by the International Committee of the Red Cross to review the Geneva Conventions. Mm-hmm. Now, my question to you is, why doesn't the ICRC undertake the same procedure to bring together nations of the world? There were about 120 countries that attended those two conferences in 1971 and 1972.
Mm-hmm. Quite right. And you know, there may be that path towards some kind of convention which prohibits the use of nuclear weapons. That is possible. It may be through the processes of the Nuclear Non-Proliferation Treaty, or it may be through some other new means, some new diplomatic process leading to a convention. But what I have to say is the International Committee of the Red Cross has taken the view that it won't go into that space because it's a highly contested and challenging space, but will rather focus on the question of the principles, these fundamental principles of international humanitarian law, and say that it's and recognise it is a matter for governments which path they choose. But the ultimate goal is very clearly articulated, and it's some kind of convention or some international prohibition on the use of nuclear weapons.
First of all, I agree that the threat is just as important, if not more important now, having lived through the 60s, and because we have the third power in the Cold War scenario now, we have China as well as Russia and the United States. So I think there's no doubt that the threat is huge. But I wanted to ask, have the Geneva Conventions themselves ever been changed? And surely the respect that they are afforded would be a way that could be used indirectly, perhaps, to further the principles that you're talking about.
As I mentioned in my lecture, the Geneva Conventions don't refer to specific weapons, and I think it's perhaps unlikely that they will be amended in some way by a new convention to take us. It may be possible. It's one, you know, anything is possible. But I think it probably more likely that one of the other pathways that I've referred to are going to be adopted. And, you know, it is also conceivable that the International Court of Justice could again examine this issue. And I thought that the reference that, you know, I made to the submission by Gareth Evans was very interesting. I'd forgotten that until I started to prepare this lecture. But, you know, there's a history here of Australia being strong on this issue. And, you know, I think it should happen again.
You mentioned that there was widespread state agreement that the humanitarian consequences of the use of nuclear weapons would probably outweigh any possible military gain from it. Do you think, in light of that, that we might be anywhere close to a customary principle of law banning the use of those weapons, and that maybe if nuclear weapons opinion were handed down today, that it would be decided differently?
Well, it could be decided differently, but as you would know, whether or not a principle of customary international law comes into existence is often a very contested space for some time, and I think the global community needs something more urgent and more definitive and unambiguous than that gentle evolution towards what may be the ultimate goal. So I think that a path to some diplomatic process, and it's for governments to determine what that be, is the most important thing we can push for. And this is an extraordinary time. I can't begin to tell you what it's like to go to conferences like that event in Mexico and hear these powerful statements, you know, from such diverse countries as Austria, from Mexico, to hear the Pacific Red Cross societies being referred to by the Pacific Island governments as having influenced them on this issue is tremendously uplifting. And as I say, you know, I'm deeply an optimist. But, you know, if we're going to move this forward, we need to re-energise the debate. You know, we need to get people thinking and talking about this issue and remind our parliamentarians that, you know, what they'll be judged on is the legacy that they leave. Thank you.